So let's get started. Professor Fisahn, he is professor at law, public law. He chairs and holds a professorship here for public law. He told me that he is mainly interested in law and democracy, Rechtsstaat und Demokratie. And I think that fits very well because that's deep underlying also our concern. We are concerned that we're losing our participation in our democracy with some of the kinds of implementation of certain law principles. So please enlighten us on your perspective to this, and later on we discuss your findings.
Good evening. I don't know if I can enlighten you, but I will try my very best. I want to set out and explain three theses on the precautionary principle. The first thesis, the content of the precautionary principle is not very precise, and therefore in practice there's often a considerable lack of enforcement. In German jurisprudence, precaution is a parallel term to risk, two sides of the coin. Both are to be distinguished from the old task of the police, the protection against threats or danger. The protection against danger has been the task of the Polizei, written with in the old way with the Y, since 1794. Since the Preußisches Allgemeines Landrecht, General Prussian Common Law. I don't know if this translation is correct. Today it is a task of the police and the regulatory authorities. Risk is a minus to danger, and the precaution should take effect before the danger actually arrives. The term risk probably originates from a German discussion. The sociologist Ulrich Beck wrote a book in 1986 entitled The Risikogesellschaft, Risk Society. This marked the beginning of an intensive discussion on the environment and risk. His thesis at the time was that society was no longer characterized by dangers such as poverty and hunger, but is characterized by environmental risks. Today we know he was wrong. The environmental risks were added to poverty. However, Ulrich Beck avoided developing a clear concept of risk. That is what lawyers did. They looked for the difference between risk and danger. It is doubtful whether this was worth it. The German legislator, for example, has used the word risk in environmental law so far only in genetic engineering law. Otherwise, it appears in the Passengers Transport Act and as risk management in the water law. In particular, Gerd Winter, my teacher in environmental law in Bremen, has pointed out that the risk represents a minus to danger. Danger is a well-established term in police regulations, and it is defined by five elements. The damage of a legal right, causation of the damage, causality between causation and damage, probability of damage, and the near future. If one element is missing, we assume a risk. It's better to say that if there exists an uncertainty about a constituent element of danger, we assume it to be a risk. In other words, risk is the answer to uncertainty in the area of the effects of environmental intervention. For example, it is not known exactly whether a new chemical substance is harmful to health. We do not know exactly which emissions lead to forest dieback. This is relevant, for example, in emission control law. Emissions represent dangers, emissions create a risk, because we do not know whether and with which recipients they arrive and how they work there. In this respect, the distinction is quite practicable and is readily accepted by students of environmental law. That is why it is possible to take legal action against emissions before German courts. There's a subjective public right, ein subjektiv öffentliches Rechts, something special German. That means a subjective right that can be violated. Not so with emissions. a complaint against emissions is inadmissible because in the first view, nobody is directly hurt. But of course, in the end, the emission cause changes somewhere possible damages. If you think more carefully, however, there are doubts. Let us take the lighting of a cigarette at a petrol station as an example. This is a classic danger in police law. The assumption depends on the probability that a spark hits petrol. However, this cannot be determined exactly at all. So it is uncertain, and it is a risk after all. The branch above the road that has been bent by the storm is typically considered as a danger. However, it is uncertain whether it will cause damage if it falls. The time dimension is also completely uncertain, so it's just a risk. In fact, the distinction between risk and danger always includes a proper proportionality analysis and a cost-benefit analysis. It is only a minor intervention to ban smoking at petrol stations. On the other hand, the benefits of smoking whenever I want are extremely small in relation to the potential damage. In everyday language, risk has another component, namely a subjective dimension. When I speed across a full motorway at 250 kilometers per hour, it is considered risky driving. That is the driver's perspective. From the perspective of the other road users, however, the driver firstly is an idiot, and secondly, a danger. The speedster is not only a risk for the others, also it is uncertain whether an accident will happen or not. Another example, when I walk alone through the Indian jungle as the Western European urban citizen, I subjectively take a risk because dangers objectively lurk there. Air pollution emissions are objectively a danger, subjectively only a risk, which only materializes when someone becomes the recipient. Then these emissions become an individual danger to his health. Emissions limited values then are, and this is where the difference lies, also part of hazard prevention, not only precaution. In short terms, the distinction between risk and danger is extremely vague. It always depends on the extent of the damage, and it depends on the probability of damage occurring. Really relevant is the problem of uncertainty in causality, or if occurring damages cannot be proven scientifically exact. The European Union has committed itself to the